Are you prepared to say this? Say it. Say it again. Elijah said, now come to me. And all the people came to him. And then he stood with the people and prepared the altar of the Lord. Remember in 2 Kings chapter 5, remember when Naaman, the head of the Syrian army, had leprosy? And the king sent a letter because of a little girl that said, you know, Israel, you know, there's a God there that does miracles. Send a letter to the king and said, you know, here's my commander of my army. And the king tore his clothes and said, am I God to heal or make alive or cure? And, you know, and Elisha heard. And he sent a letter back. He said, let him come to me. Then he will find out that there is a prophet in Israel. Come on. I tell you, I dare you. I release you. I loosen you. I speak over your life. It's time to say, I've got it. I can do it. I've got the power to set you free. Verse 36, and it came to pass at the time of the offering of the evening sacrifice that Elijah the prophet came near and said, Lord God of Abraham, Isaac, and Israel. And there you can just see he reminded God of his promises. Because in that time, that's where the promises was. Let it be known this day, listen to this, that you are God and I am your servant. And that I have done all these things at your word. Hear me, O Lord, hear me. That this people may know you are God. And that you have turned their hearts back. Then the fire of the Lord fell. Bam! Consumed the stones, the dust, the offering, the sacrifice. Licked up the water in the trench. And when all the people saw it, they fell down and said, the Lord is God. The Lord is God. And Elijah prophesied, verse 41, and said, there's a sound of abundance of rain. Verse 42, so Ahab went up to eat and drink, and Elijah went up to the top of Carmel, cast himself down upon the earth, put his face between his knees. After he prayed the fire down, he prophesied. He prophesied the rain that didn't fall for 3.5 years. Yet, he had to pray 7 times for the rain to come. And the way he prayed, he put his head between his knees. That is called travail. That is the way a woman gives birth in the East. Okay? You go to the black communities up in northern Transvaal, they sit on their haunches and give birth. You go to the white hospital, they lie on their backs. You go to the East, they put their heads between their knees. Different ways of giving birth. Okay? So, what was Elijah doing? He was going into travail. He said, I'm going to give birth to this rain thing. So I want to ask you, how many prophecies have you got? How many dreams have you got? How many visions have you got of what God wants to do, what he said he will do? Maybe you've got nothing, but you've got a whole book full. What would you do to get this stuff to work in your life? Chapter 19. And Ahab told Jezebel all that Elijah had done. Verse 2, then Jezebel sent a messenger unto Elijah saying, so let the gods do to me. The gods that he just killed, the prophets of, he now get a message from these false gods that you're going to die before tomorrow. He says, by tomorrow this time, you're a dead man. When he saw that, he arose and he ran for his life. King James said he went for his life. He ran, man, to Beersheba, where belongeth to Judah, and left his servant there. You know, he didn't leave his servant there. He ran away from his servant. His servant couldn't keep up. For somebody that want to go study this stuff. But he himself went a day's journey into the wilderness and came and sat down under a juniper tree, and he requested for himself that he might die. And he said, it's enough, Lord. take away my life. I'm not better than this. But he went himself, and you know, verse 7, and the angel of the Lord came again a second time, touched him and said, arise, eat, because your journey is too great. Listen here. If you want to run away from your problem, listen to this word. God will give you the strength to run away from your problem. God will even help you. He'll even send you support. Have you ever read Psalm 105, 106, and 107? God says, the children of Israel cried unto him for bread. He gave them the desires of their heart, but sent a leanness into their soul, that they ate the bread till it came out of their nostrils, and they vomited the bread out that they ate. But I said, they ate angels' food, yet they vomited it out. It's not God's idea to give them the bread. It was their idea. God wanted to do much more supernatural stuff for them than that. They said they limited the Holy One of Israel. If you are not living in the presence of the Almighty God, if you walk out and listen to the rumors that's outside, and you start and fear starts getting hold of you and you start acting, God will support you. I got the whole Bible. God will support you. God supported Elijah, even sent an angel to bake him food, said, if you want to run, run, but you're going to run for 40 days and 40 nights. So I want to say, stay in the presence of the Almighty God. Get the word of the Lord. Don't get a word from Jezebel. Don't get a word from Balaam. Don't get a word from wicked political leaders. Get a word from the Lord. If this is what God says, this is where we're going to go. He just prayed down fire. Just prayed down rain. Now he runs away from a woman. He just killed all 850 of her prophets. Personally cut their necks off. Now the woman that's in charge of them, he fears her. So God says, you want fear? I'll help you. So he arose and ate and drank, verse 8, and went in the strength of that meat for 40 days and 40 nights unto Horeb, the mount of God, verse 9. And he came to a cave and lodged there, and behold, the word of the Lord came to him and said, what are you doing here, Elijah? And he said, I've been very jealous for the Lord, the children of Israel forsook his covenant, threw down their altars, slay their prophets. I am the only one left. And he said, and God said, go forth and stand upon the mountain before the Lord. When God spoke the first time, it was passing him by. It was a fleeting thing. What are you doing here, Elijah? He said, and he was moaning. He was in depression. He was having the blues. I'm the only one left in the prophet. But he didn't speak to God. He was speaking to himself, thinking that God is him and him is God. It was just a fleeting thing. So Elijah sitting there, God says, what are you doing here, Elijah? You've ran for 40 days and 40 nights by the food that I send an angel to give you. What are you doing here? Then the word of the Lord came to him again. Said, Elijah, you were used to say, the Lord before whom I stand. Would you just come out of that mood and come stand before me? Would you just come and stand before me? Listen, come and stand before the Lord. And behold, the Lord passed by, just like Exodus 33 with Moses. A great strong wind rent the mountains, broke in pieces the rocks before the Lord. The Lord, not in the wind. And after the wind, an earthquake. The Lord, not in the earthquake. After the earthquake, a fire. The Lord, not in the fire. Okay. So what was the wind, the earthquake? What was the fire? What was it? It is, God says, a fire goes before him. And so he says, God is on his way, Elijah. You just stood out of your blues. And the fact that you stood up, here's God coming. See the wind? See the... It's not God. It's just, here's the sun. God is on his way. There's his chariot coming. You want to read Exodus? Fire on the mountain, smoke, shaking, earthquakes. God was not there. And he said, and after the earthquake, God came down and spoke to Moses. And then a still, small voice. And it was so when Elijah heard it, he wrapped his face in his mantle, went and stood in the entering of the cave, and behold, there came a voice unto him and said, what are you doing here, Elijah? The exact same is before the Lord said, go out. And he said, the same story. I have been jealous. The house of Israel, they have forsaken thy covenant. Same story. Slain their prophets. I'm the only one left. And the Lord says, go, return on your way. In other words, go back where you last left the Holy of Holies. And go do your job. Go anoint the king, go anoint the prophet, go and do some stuff. Man. James chapter 5. Verse 17. Elijah was a man subject to like passions as we are. One day up, next day down. Kill 850 prophets, then run away from the woman. Elijah was a man subject to like passion, and he prayed earnestly that it might not rain. Now, we have no record where he prayed not for the rain. We only have a record where he said to Ahab, it will not rain. But then we have a record where he said it will rain. And he prayed earnestly, and it rained not. And he prayed again. And the heaven gave rain, and the earth brought forth her fruit. How did he pray? Travailing, intensive prayer over and over and over. So what am I trying to tell you? I'm saying, you know, what are we doing with our prayer life? Verse 16. Confess your faults one to another. Pray one for another that you may be healed. Next portion. Amplified Bible. The earnest, heartfelt, continued prayer of a righteous man makes tremendous power available, which is dynamic in its working. Verse 11. Behold, we count them happy which endure. You have heard of the patience of Job and have seen the end of the Lord, that the Lord is very pitiful and of tender mercy. Job chapter 22. Verse 21 amplified. Acquaint yourself with him, that is with God. Agree with God. Show yourself to be conformed to his will. And be at peace. By that you shall prosper, and great good shall come to you. Receive, I pray you, the law and instruction from his mouth. Lay up his words in your heart. If you return to the Almighty, you shall be built up. You shall put away iniquity from your tabernacles. Then you shall lay up gold as dust. You know the revelation there. You dust the house today, tomorrow the dust is there again. You dust the house the next day the dust is there again. So God says, if you do what I'm telling you, you're going to lay up gold as dust. In other words, it'll never dry up. It'll just always be there. If you think you've used it up, it's there again. Yes, the Almighty shall you be your fence, for then you shall have the delight in the Almighty, and he shall lift up your face. Verse 27, you shall make your prayer unto him, and he shall hear you. Verse 28, you shall decree a thing, and it shall be established. Wow. Chapter 42, verse 10 says, and Job prayed for his friends, and God turned his captivity and gave him twice as much as he had before. Though I have all knowledge of prayer, though I know all mysteries about prayer, though I read all books on prayer, though I listened to all CDs on prayer, except I pray, I'll never learn to pray. We had in our country in the 50s and 60s and the early 70s a man by the name of William Duma, a black preacher in a white community in the Ungeni Road Baptist Church in Durban. Raised people from the dead, saw the most awesome miracles, pray the power of God down, saw miracles that will make your ears scream for hours. He read a book by Sundar Singh. Sadhu Sundar Singh, the age of 16, wanted to throw himself in front of a train in India. And the Lord met him, appeared unto him and said, I am Jesus. And Sundar Singh was thrown out of the very rich Sikh family, the Singhs. And he started following Jesus, became the biggest preacher India ever had. Saw so many miracles. When he came about 7 miles from a village hospital, people in the hospital started getting healed. Without, and then they would say, Sundar must be close by. So William Dumas read this life story of Sundar Singh and he decided that's going to be his life. Sundar Singh said, it's not enough to have the fire. It must be constantly kindled by prayer. So William Dumas made a vow to God. He said, as long as I live, every night at 12 o'clock, I will get up to pray. And he said, I've kept this till the day I died. Every night at 12, he got up to pray. He said, it's not enough to have the fire. You must constantly kindle the fire by prayer. Out of the 1800 revivals, they said, sinning people don't pray, and praying people don't sin. Matthew chapter 6, verse 5. When you pray, you must not be like the hypocrites. They love to pray standing in the synagogues. Where must you stand before the Lord? And on the corners of the streets, that they may be seen by people. Truly, I tell you, they have reward in full already. But when you pray, go into your most private room. Close your door. Pray to your Father who is in secret. Your Father who sees in secret will reward you in the open. And when you pray, do not heap up phrases. Verse 8, do not be like them, for your Father knows what you need before you pray. Mark chapter 10. I want to put in a point here that's very valid. If the Almighty God, creator of heaven and earth, if he says through his only Son that was born of a virgin, that became the firstborn of many brethren, if he says through him, God knows exactly what you need, then why do I have to pray? This is what people say. Kuzad, why do you people pray such hours? If God then knows, why do you pray? Do you know? That is not what Jesus said. Listen to what Jesus said. Your Father knows what you need before you pray. I want to repeat that again. Your Father knows exactly what you need, comma, before you pray. In other words, no matter how great the need, if you don't pray. So what is God saying? He says, I know what you need in your ministry. But I want to know if you know. But with all the revelation, you can have all the adjectives and you can have, you know, everything, all the adjectives, all the revelations, all the attributes in the names of God. Oh, you are wonderful. You're my counselor, my mighty God. You are the 10,000 one. You are the brightest morning star. You can have it all. And you can try and impress God. And you can have all the revelations of who he is. Yet he says, I know exactly what you want. Stop the protocol. What do you want? Your Father knows what you need before you pray. I'm going to prove it to you in a minute. Many charged him and said, hold your peace. In other words, good Afrikaans, shut up. But he cried. He cried louder. Son of David, have mercy. Jesus stood still and commanded him to be called. And they called the blind man, saying unto him, be of good comfort. Rise, he called you. And cast down his garment, rose and came to Jesus. Now, there's a good story in that the blind people had to wear a garment to prove that they are allowed by the government to beg. So he threw off his begging garment, knowing that he's going to be healed for those who want to go. That's faith in action, okay? Okay, verse 51. And Jesus answered and said unto him, what will you that I should do unto you? The blind man said, Lord, that I may receive my sight. Your Father knows what you need before you pray. You can have all the revelations of how he answers prayer. You can have all the revelations of how God heals the sick. You can have all the revelations. God is saying, would you tell me? This is how I operate. That is why God has placed such an emphasis on prayer right through the Bible. From Genesis, Abraham is a prophet. He will pray for you. Moses is my prophet. Let him pray for you. And Jacob prayed all night long. Prayer is in every book of the Bible. God says, I need people to pray. And if they pray, they come right into my holy of holies. Here they can see a vision. They can get my word. And bam. So if I don't get a word, I ask him. Or I ask for what I need. So the book of Psalms, the book of Acts is primarily two books of prayer. So let's go to Luke 24 and Acts 1. Verse 49 says, behold, I send you the promise of my Father. This is a promise. Yeah. Listen here. I'm going to send you the promise of my Father. It's a promise. But tarry in the city of Jerusalem until you get the power. I'm going to send the promise. But, verse 53, and they were continually in the temple, praising and blessing God. Acts 1. Verse 4, and being assembled together with them, he commanded them that they should not depart from Jerusalem. See the tarry there? Go stay in Jerusalem. And wait for the promise of the Father that you heard of me. Okay, is this a promise they're going to get it? Did Jesus say they're going to get it? Did Jesus say if they wait, they're going to get it? So they only have to go sit and wait. And then they're going to get the promise. Jesus said, go sit and wait and you'll get the promise. Right? Verse 8, and you shall receive power after this Holy Ghost has come upon you. Verse 14, then they all continued with one accord in prayer and supplication. In other words, continuous pleading for the promise of the Spirit. God already said, just wait, tarry. And then they knew God knows that they need it. God promised, Elijah, show yourself to Ahab, I send rain. Elijah prophesy rain, then Elijah go pray seven times for the rain. I'm going to give you the Holy Spirit, go wait, then they go pray and plead for the Holy Spirit to come. Why do we pray continuously Monday after Monday? Come on, don't stop with your prayers. They continued with one accord in prayer. And when the day of Pentecost, chapter 2, verse 1, when the day of Pentecost was fully come, they were all with one accord. What was the one accord? He just told us. In prayer. They were with one accord in prayer. What were they praying for? For the Holy Spirit promise. But if God said it, doesn't that mean, you know, you're just getting it? Well, the Bible is full. Every time they still had to go pray for it. Every revival broke out because people prayed. 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 Chapter 4. Remember, after they healed the sick man, the gate called Beautiful, and the Pharisees were not so happy as they were. Verse 24, when they heard it, they lift up their voice with one accord. Okay, how do they lift up their voice with one accord? He told us in chapter 1, in prayer. And they said, Lord, so they're praying because they're talking to God. Lord God, which have made heaven and earth and sea and all, who by the mouth of your servant David has said, why did even now they quote Psalm 2? They're praying the words of God back to God. Verse 29, and now, Lord, behold their threatenings. And here comes John G. Lake. And give your servant that with all boldness I may speak your word. So that you will stretch out your hand to heal. Signs, wonders may be done in the name of your holy child Jesus. And when they had prayed, the place was shaken. Where they were assembled, they were all filled with the Holy Ghost. This is what they asked. And they spoke the word with boldness. This is what they asked. Verse 33, and with great power gave the apostles witness. This is what they asked. Amen. Chapter 6, chapter 13, chapter 14, you can read stuff like, whenever they wanted people to do something for God, they first prayed. Every time, whenever Paul left a city, he first got the people together and they knelt. And he prayed, said, I'm going to leave you today, I'm going to go to another city, let's pray together. Do you still pray about everything that you're going to do? Do you still pray about every venture that you take? Do you still get the people together? Come, let's take hands, let's pray. Okay? Do you still pray about everything you do? If I get in my car 10 times a day, if I get in my car, I say, thank you, Lord, for this car. Thank you that I'm traveling safely wherever I go. No, but you prayed in the morning that God will protect you. So Paul prayed every time that he did anything. Acts chapter 9 and 10 is the following story. Paul is on his road to persecute the church. A light struck him down. Jesus speaks and said, "Why do you persecute me?" He said, "Who are you, Lord?" "I am Jesus." "Go to the street called Straight." And as he got there, God comes to Ananias. He says, "Ananias, go to the street called Straight. There's a man by the name of Saul. Behold, he is praying." And while Ananias was praying, the Lord spoke and said, "I have shown him how much." And as Paul was praying, he saw a man by the name of Ananias laying hands on him and said, "Saul, brother." And as Ananias was praying, he saw the man Saul being filled with the Spirit. And as Saul was praying, prayer can give you divine connections. Chapter 10. Cornelius is praying, and an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a vision and said, "Go to Simon the tanner," because there's Simon Peter. Simon Peter is praying at Simon Tanner's house. And as he's praying, he's seeing a vision, three men coming to get him at the door. And the angel of the Lord said, "Go down to them." God says to this guy, "Send men there." God, so if you pray, somewhere you'll get a connection. You never know what your future holds if you don't pray. You know, prayer will open doors, will break through visions, will bring stuff your way, will make divine connections. And before you know it, you'll get, "Oh, would you come pray here? Would you come preach here?" You know, I pray.